Thank you. morning. Ta-da! Good morning. Happy Pentecost to all of you. Today is Pentecost Sunday, the Sunday in the church year when we remember that the Holy Spirit came to the disciples and sent them out into the world. I'm so glad you could be here today. And I'm glad that I have any fragment of a voice. I've had a terrible cold, and so we're going to see how long it lasts. And if it goes out right before the sermon, we will accept that as God's will for us today. Many of you have shared your prayer requests with me before the service on email or just by speaking to me about them. So thank you, and thank you for filling out the clipboards at the back of the room. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Lord God, it's good to be here this morning. What a beautiful sunny day you've given us, beautiful spring weekend. We thank you that we have time to be here this morning, knowing that schedules are so busy with so many things today. Thank you for those that are here. God, I ask that you would bless this hour of worship for us, that you would allow it to be renewing and refreshing to us, that through the power of your Holy Spirit, especially on Pentecost, we would be strengthened and conformed even more into the image of your Son Jesus, so that we can be better representatives out into the world. We ask today that you would hear our confession as we come to worship, that we can name before you things that we have done that were wrong, things that we want to do better next time. God, you've offered us forgiveness through Jesus and through the power of the Spirit, if we would believe. And so we ask that you would receive these confessions and help us to accept your forgiveness. Lord Jesus, talk to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It's time for the children to come forward.
Years. God wants you to know that the only real power is given through God.
The remaining stuff and roots mean that you will return to power and get your kingdom back, but first you must be humble and know that God is King of heaven and earth. The dream is a warning. You must change. You must stop being evil and be kind to others. And then maybe this won't happen. King Nebuchadnezzar did not listen to the warning of the dream. One day, while the king boasted of his power, the dream came true. For 7 years, the king acted and ate like an animal. At the end of the 7 years, the king looked up at heaven. He announced that there was only one true God. When King Nebuchadnezzar praised God and honored God's name, he became a better king than he had ever been before. Isn't that an interesting story about humility? Learning to be humble and saying the greatest thing in the whole world is not me, it's God. Right? That's learning to be humble. Okay, guys, you have the first day of VBS Sunday School today. Amanda's going to be teaching you. You're going to be doing songs and I think a video lesson. It's going to be cool. We're going to do it all summer. Good times. But first, today is June 4th, and the month of June is when we collect food for the food pantry from everyone who's coming to church. Yes, it is your birthday month, and Calvin's birthday month, and Eva's birthday month. Wonderful. So, we have a bread wagon right here up front, and I know the Fisher's food is right there. Anybody who brought food for the food pantry, hold your hand up so the kids can go ahead and bring the wagon down, and we'll collect the food. Daniel, can you play some food collection music? When you send your spirit, they are created. and you renew the face of the ground. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He who looks at the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May the meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord. Praise the Lord, my soul. Praise the Lord. Now please hear the scripture lesson from the book of Micah.
Micah 6 over verses no. Micah 6 verses 6 through 8. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of lambs, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O mortal, what is good and what does the Lord require of you. Just act justly and love mercy when you walk humbly with the Lord.
Do justice, love, mercy, and walk humbly with your God. Beautiful. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this time and space to be here, to be attending to you in a way maybe we don't during the week. We thank you for these beautiful words of scripture from your prophet Micah and ask that you would help us to consider humility this morning. We ask that you would help me to speak, help my voice this morning, help me to think clearly. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. So if you ever thought the Lord did not have a sense of humor, God definitely does have a sense of humor. I've seen it so many times, but one example is that the week that we're preaching on humility is the week that I pretty much lose my voice in the worst way that I ever have in my life. And I thought, how on earth am I going to get up there and preach on humility when I don't even have a voice? Maybe I'm being taught humility this morning. So, thank you, Lord, for a little joke. So, I want to ask you, in your mind, you can conjure up definitions or images of humility, our theme for this week. I want you to listen to two responses to the same compliment and tell me which one is the more humble response. I have some plants here. Stand up, plants. Oh, sure, yeah, come on up. Not humble here. Come on up. Hey, Carolyn, what a really pretty dress. I really love that. Is that new?
It is, but I think it makes me look fat.
Okay. Dee, what a pretty romper. There's been a lot of rompers in the news lately. I've noticed that. Have you seen the romper for men? The romp him? I've been very upset. What a pretty romper. I love it. It looks nice on you.
Thank you. It makes me feel pretty.
Okay. Did you hear them? Which response was more humble? Carolyn says, I think it makes me look fat. It's going to vote for her. Hands up. Hands up. She says, I think it makes me look pretty. We got some hands. Okay. All right. We're going to go for that. So stay right there. I can lean on you. Turns out, as I look at the word humility and look at the definition of it, especially interestingly, if you look at the people in the recovery community talk a lot about humility. Humility has to do with not low self-esteem or putting yourself down, but it has to do with having an accurate conception of yourself, an accurate point of view of yourself, that you would be able to look at yourself and say, these are the things that I'm good at, and these are the deficits that I have. And you could just look at yourself straight on. In fact, maybe look at yourself the way that God sees you, as a beloved creature of God, someone God created, who has a certain gift set and certain areas where there are some deficits. Just be straight honest about it. So what about this? If I said, hey guys, I was listening to the music this morning and I love what we sing. I really appreciate your ministry. But Carolyn, I just noticed you were a little pitchy today.
Yeah, you know, I think that I really stink as a singer and I should just stop on doing that.
That's one example. I love the ministry you guys bring. Thank you so much. Music, pretty good this morning, but I noticed you were a little pitchy.
Yeah, I'm still learning, so I have my ways to go, so I'll learn.
Okay. Maybe obvious now, but which one was more humble? Carolyn, hands. Carolyn? Deanna, hands. All right, good. You guys learned fast. Give me my hand. Go ahead and sit down. I want you to notice what Deanna said. She said, I'm still learning. I still have room to grow. And this is where another key component of the word humility comes into play. Because the word, the root of the word, for those of you who like etymology, is humus. You know what humus is?
Yeah, you don't eat it. Why don't you look at me when you're done, so I don't know if you're right now. Again, if you're looking here in the back, right, and you play writing list of three songs. Three things you're good at, and three things where you need growth. Okay, well, hopefully you have at least two at this point each year. Peg is done. All right. Good. I'm going to keep going. You can have two. That's fine. Someone like to share? something you're good at, someone who doesn't mind, is not embarrassed, not easily, okay. Well then, okay, Carolyn, tell me what you're good at.
Being a mother.
Carolyn? All right, now, I want you to take the compliment the right way this time. Carolyn, I think you're a great mom.
Thank you very much.
Okay, good for you. Someone else want to share something they're good at? Yeah,
Peg? Helping people.
Peg, that's true. Peg, I think you're great at helping people.
Oh, thanks.
That makes me feel good. All right, good. Now, deficits. Anybody want to share a deficit? Okay, Kevin.
Public speaking.
Public speaking. Okay, now remember, humble response. Kevin, we need someone to speak today, and I'm thinking maybe I'm going to ask Noah. Let me try that again.
That was good.
Anyways, yeah. Kevin, so when you come up to speak before the church, Kevin, is it okay if I work with you because I notice it's not your strongest natural gift set? I think that would be great for me to learn. Okay. He didn't say I stink, go ask no one. Someone else want to share a deficit? Thank you very much. Somebody else? Kathy.
Organization.
Organization. Kathy, be humble now. I just got a look at the desk in your office, and I know you keep the records for a business, and I was horrified at Kathy. How do you find anything there?
I have a hard time too.
And that's an area of growth, right? An area where you can grow. So I want you to think about that. When you look at your lists, if someone gives you that compliment for something that you know that you're good at, that is a compliment right to God who gave you that gift, right? So can you just receive that compliment and say thank you? Like, thank you, that brings me joy, it makes me feel good. Thanks for saying something kind. Just say yes. You don't have to turn it down. You don't have to turn it into, oh no, women especially are champions of this. Oh no, no, not me, right? Don't insult God. God gave you that gift. Be humble. Say, thank you. Thank you. Praise God, right? And when someone points out truthfully something, a place where you have a deficit, it's okay to say that's my growing area. I'm still growing. You know, just acknowledge it and be ready to grow. Okay, four quick things about humble people. Number one, humble people are teachable. They are teachable. The thing is, if you lack humility, you already know everything. You don't need to learn a thing. But when you have learned something, what you are saying by a logical extension is that prior to learning that, you didn't know it, or you might be wrong. Do you know, and I was going to talk about climate change, but I'm not, okay? Just keep that in mind. You think about that. Do you know a person who, when you say, hey, Albert, did you know a cup of coffee costs $7.99 at Dunkin' Donuts? And Albert says, no, it doesn't. And I say, yes, it does. And Albert says, no, it doesn't. And I say, yes, it does. I can't preach loud this morning. Right? They just get louder, and they just get more aggressive, and they just get up in your face because they can't be taught anything. That is the lack of humility. But when I say, did you know a cup of coffee costs $7.99 at Dunkin' Donuts? And Albert says, oh, no, it doesn't. Here's the thing. It's $1.79. Now I'm teachable. And I say, oh, I didn't know that. I'm ready to learn. People who are humble are ready to learn. People who cannot be taught anything lack humility. Number two, Pentecost. The story of Pentecost. Today, Pentecost Sunday, my voice is just absolutely hurting me. Who knows the story of Pentecost? Somebody tell me. Do you think when those people in that room started speaking in all those different tongues. Do you think that when they talked about it later, they were like, oh yeah, no, I'm really good at foreign languages. That was all me. I totally studied that in school. I know foreign languages. You think they said that? I don't think they did. I think they said the only reason I was able to do that is because the power of the Holy Spirit in me. I take no credit for that at all. And the point about this, point number two, is this. The more real your experience with the Holy Spirit, the higher your humility. I absolutely believe this is true. If you have seen the Holy Spirit working in your life, if you've seen the Holy Spirit working in the world, the more you've seen it, the less you take credit for the good that you do. If you see the Holy Spirit work and then something great happens and you're standing nearby and they say, Rachel, that was really good that you just did that, I know that was not me. That was the power of God. So point number one is that you're teachable. Point number two is your level of humility has everything to do with your experience of the Holy Spirit and God's power in this world. Two more. All right. Oh, no. But in fact, the Holy Spirit being strong in your life means that you have a strong level of humility, and that ties right into the scripture lesson that Jackson read to us this morning. What are we called to do? Do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. We know that we are walking with God and humbly with God. We know what our gifts are and we know what God's gifts are, right? And so we're able to do great things, justice and mercy, because we have that humility walking with the Spirit of God. Third point, who gets embarrassed easily here? You've been embarrassed, okay? Okay. So take this on for a challenge. This came across in my reading about humility. If you are humble, if you have accepted your gifts as God has given them, and you've accepted the deficits that you have as God has given them, you will be less embarrassed. You will be less humiliated. Oh, because I think we all feel embarrassed and humiliated sometimes, right? Especially when your mother sits and corrects your sermon, right? I wish you were here to hear that. She's bringing handbells this morning. Tell her I said it. It's really easy to be embarrassed, right? But if you are fully accepting that these are the gifts and deficits that God has given me, when something happens that would be embarrassing, you can say, that's okay. This is just what God has given me. I'm an expression of God's heart. And yeah, there's deficits in me, but that's okay, right? I'm cool with that. This is not the neatest moment, but I am cool with who I am. So your level of embarrassment can go down. So number one, teachable. Two, your experience of the Holy Spirit indicates your level of humility. And number three, your embarrassment will go down. Last thing, if you have a strong sense of humility, it does not matter what job you are given when you are working for God. It does not matter what job you are given when you are working for God. I can remember one time sitting on the bathroom floor in the first stall of the ladies' room with a scrub brush during spring cleaning, cleaning the backside of the commode on the floor. That is gross. Gross. Gross? Yes? Yes. And all I was thinking is, I love this church. I love this church. I love this church. I don't want to do this in the men's room. I love the church. I did do it in the men's room. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. You don't need to have this role, or that role, because you are an expression of God's heart, right? And that's where it comes from. So you can be given a very humble assignment and say, that's all right, because I know where I get my worth, right? I get it from God, and I am an expression of God's heart. I'm going to leave it there, friends. But think about humility. Think about that dirt and that potential for growth that you have, the potential that you can help other people to grow out of the strengths that you have, and the potential that you have to grow out of your own deficits. Amen. Thank you. When we celebrate communion at Aldersgate, it is an open table, so that means whether you come forward or not is up to you. It's between you and God, but you are welcome according to this church. We serve grape juice and gluten-free bread during communion so that all can participate. The ushers will direct you to come forward up the center aisles and return to your seats either around that side aisle or back on the center aisle this way. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. In the beginning, your Spirit moved over the face of the waters. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. Your Spirit came upon prophets and teachers, anointing them to speak your word. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. At his baptism in the Jordan, your Spirit descended upon him and declared him your beloved Son. With your Spirit on him, he turned away the temptation of sin. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always, baptizing us with the Holy Spirit and with fire, as on the day of Pentecost. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." On the day you raised him from the dead, he was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of bread, and in the power of your Holy Spirit, your church has continued in the breaking of bread and the sharing of the cup. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood and empowered by the gifts of the Spirit. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, showing forth the fruit of the Spirit until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
The table is prepared. Please come.
Thank you.
humbly into the world. Amen. Team effort so we can accomplish it next Sunday.
Bobby, you're going to be doing some painting in the Ed Wing. Are you in need of help? Do you know when you're going to be doing it?
Yes. I think right now it's starting at least tomorrow, sometime in the afternoon and or evening. We haven't decided yet. I'll send out a mass text to people that I know, the usual suspects. But yes, there is the two classrooms that Bright Start has vacated, and Pam with the Woods Edge Nursery School's coming into. We're going to be washing down the walls, painting them, priming them, getting it all nice and looking good for us. So anybody that knows how to paint or learn to paint, step on in.
Okay, so please, if you're not on Bobby's usual suspect text list for painting, and you want to help, starting maybe tomorrow afternoon and talk to him. Very good. Kitchen update.
Well, he's walking up, put a shameless plug in for the Main Mission Trip GoFundMe thing.
Oh, that's right. We created a GoFundMe page to help with the materials cost for the Main Mission Trip. I was waiting until the Buzz Off for Cancer was over, which is today, to really send that out to the church, but it's such an easy way for the church to raise awareness and raise money about the Main Mission Trip. If you, when you see it come through on the church email or when you see it on Facebook, you would share it. If you, you know, any amount obviously will make a difference, but we have a $2,500 goal. We're over 10% of the way there, having just started it. But the more you share it, the more will help more gifts come in to reach that $2,500 goal. Thanks, Bob.
All right. I'll be quick. I'm here on behalf of a lot of people that are working on planning for kitchen expansion. I think I was asked because I apparently have been told I'm going to be chairman of trustees next year, and I don't know what I've done over the last 6 years, but I've been thinking a lot about this, and as trustees, I think we're custodians of three things at this church. It's the physical building, any money that's given to us by people for capital projects, and the time, the service that people put in, and to be a custodian of that and not abuse it. And the kitchen expansion is a big project, but I've come to realize one of the big questions I had, is it really necessary? Are we trying to build a Taj from a kitchen? And we don't really need it. And we only operate that kitchen right now on the good faith of the health inspector. He gives us variances every year. It's getting worse and worse, and it's got to be done, or we won't have a functional kitchen. We won't be able to serve the breakfasts. And the sermon this morning, the humility and feeling the Holy Spirit, the time of the church where I felt it most acutely is when we went to a free breakfast, and we went from serving 40 people to 100, and just the Holy Spirit and that decision, and how much that's blessed this church. And it's the thing that I enjoy most at this church right now, is the church breakfast, getting ready for it, serving those people, and what it does for the community. So I just want to say that we're going to have a charge conference coming up. We're going to require, we need a vote from the church in support of it. I would ask for your support. It's necessary. As chairman of trustees, I'll do all that I can to make sure that we take care of the building, your time, and your money, and use it the best way possible. We have a lot of people that are willing to help out doing cabinetry, drywall. I will take care of that service. One last thing. My dad was on trustees at a Methodist church in Virginia, and he always lamented that 90% of the work at the church was done by 10% of the people, and how much those people had to give. And that's not the case here. I guess the only reason this project will be successful is because we have such a broad base. Looking around, almost every one of you, I bet, will give something to this church, to this kitchen expansion. And because of that, I know that it will be successful. So come to charge conference in a couple weeks, hear what we have to say, and vote your conscience, and we'll go from there. Thank you.
We appreciate all the leadership coming from the kitchen team right now, the great work you all are doing. For celebration and thanks, we have two. One is to the Buzz Off crew. We happen to have a picture. They buzzed off before church started, so we were able to get it in PowerPoint. Take a look at these guys. Isn't that great? And what happened? So there they are. Does anybody know how much money the team has raised? I should know this, and they don't. Anybody have an idea? I guess we'll find out later. But good for them. They went and did that this morning. I know it was at least a couple thousand dollars, but I think John has a corporate match, so it'll be more than that. Good for them.
Let's give him a hand. I also just, I know she'll be embarrassed, but I want to celebrate joining McNally this morning because no one had signed up for coffee hour as of yesterday, and my mom was going to be gone today. She's usually the fallback, and I thought, oh, man. So I texted over to Joni, and I said, hey, Joni, if you're going to be at church tomorrow, would you mind doing the coffee hour? And I felt bad that it was last minute. Like 3 seconds later, I had a text back saying, sure thing, chicken wing. So great. It just made me feel like it was no sweat. So thank you for your generosity and your graciousness, Kathy.
$3,400
has been raised by the bus office.
That's on the page, and you can still donate to the end of the month.
Yep, you can still donate through the end of June.
They need extra money for sunscreen now.
Next Saturday and Sunday, really need your help on that. And the 2 minute rule, and we are good to go. Zephyr Amanda.
Food pantry collected 30 items.
Thank you. The food pantry collected 30 items today. And so we will beat that handily next Sunday, because next Sunday we're going to remember, right?
Right.
All right. Please stand for the benediction. May the God who has sent us the Holy Spirit to his original church, to the church of so many years into the church of today, be with us and remain with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hey guys, right before we go, not trying to cause embarrassment at all, but I want to acknowledge Emily Baraka, who's here this morning, Gail Montes' mother. Emily is one of the founding generation of this church. Raise your hand, Emily. Just so people know who you are, make sure to say hello to Emily, because if she and her generation of people, along with Sarah LaMonica, had not been here 50 plus years ago, we would not have what we have. So,
we're not happy, are we?